can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There is nothing. There's nothing that can stop our God.
Hi, my name is Dale Stout, and I am the lead pastor here at First Assembly, and I just want to welcome you to our Good Friday gathering online. And this is a time that we get to truly reflect on what you might call the penalty phase of what Christ has done for us, and kind of a time to consider, you know, deeply consider all of the implications that go along with the cross. So Pastor Marcos, our Next Gen pastor, is with us today. And I just want to have a kind of a conversation, just conversation about those implications of the cross. And we want to invite you to come along with us. And so so as we begin, I want to look at I don't know, maybe some of the events that took place just hours before, you know, what this day represents. And I want to talk along the way about, you know, maybe some of the personalities involved. There's certain key players that are engaged. And I thought a great way to kind of start would be to ask you, within the framework of this storyline, but maybe just in general, I don't know. So here's it. Do you have a personal, I don't know, favorite disciple? And if so, why?
Okay. Well, I do, but it's probably not for the reasons why people think. It's Peter.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of people pick Peter because of all the great things he does. I actually pick him for the exact opposite. I pick him for how screwed up and messed up he was, and for finding a very creative way in getting into trouble.
Yeah, I think a lot of people relate to Peter. He's one of my favorites too. You can't not love Peter because he's so honest and real, and there's that kind of grittiness to all of that, and we relate so well to Peter because, you know, our lives are kind of a mess, and some people relate better than others, you know, in terms of just the personality too. Peter's personality, he's the guy that always spoke up.
Yeah, I mean, he found a good way of getting himself into trouble. He just by opening his mouth, and he would just do that all the time.
But you also have to look at it. Peter was fearless, right? He was a great leader. He had to learn some skills along the way, which Jesus helped him do that. But he's a born leader, you know, you might say, and he was fearless. He'd stand up and say whatever was on his mind, which is why he got so in trouble all the time. So, yeah, I like Peter as well. And he's probably one of my favorites. But within this framework, and probably in general, probably the runner up to him for me personally would be Thomas. I love Thomas. Thomas is another one. He's just he's just very genuine. And I can relate to him because Thomas, he would process everything. Everything was about a process. And so he, in fact,
it's still an odd choice though, picking Thomas.
Well, maybe, but look, here's the deal. So Thomas is tagged with being the doubting Thomas, right? But why? It was because the crowd all came to him and said, hey, we've seen Jesus, you know, and all this, but he didn't want to just buy whatever the crowd said. He wanted to check that out, and he needed to know for himself empirical truth. As I read Thomas, okay, and again, it's how I'm reading Thomas. Was very, very important to him, and yeah, I mean he's flawed too, but he's very genuine, and I just think the real Thomas was probably a lot deeper than this surface, the doubting Thomas that we get. He's also the very first disciple who acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ, which is pretty impressive. He's very inquisitive, and so he just doesn't want to take things at face value, and so for that I really appreciate Thomas. And there are other disciples. You know, you think about what there's a few that we know little bits and pieces of. Peter probably the most, and others come along, but then you just don't know. I mean, Bartholomew might have been the greatest guy, you know, in the entire crowd. We just don't know enough about him, right?
I mean, he probably could have moved mountains, but I'll say this. I think that's probably, he's got the coolest name. I'll give him credit for that. We don't really know much about him, but I know his name. It's not a real popular name among Christian circles, but I think it's a strong, like, legit name. I think that'd be pretty cool, seeing little kids, Bartholomew, get over here.
So your next child, you could call him Bartholomew?
I don't know. Bart for short.
Yeah. Bart. So those, there are a number of these characters involved in this account, and but you can't look at this moment in history without also having a conversation about Judas. So let's talk about Judas for just a moment. What is your take on Judas?
So I tend to take a different road when it comes to Judas, because I know a lot of times Judas gets pegged as a traitor, and I don't really see Judas as a traitor entirely. I just see Judas more as being impatient. Because when you start reading the history and you start reading about Judas's intentions, his intentions wasn't to get Jesus arrested. His intention was to get Jesus to reveal himself to everybody that he was the Christ, that he was all powerful, that he was almighty, and that essentially that they were going to overthrow the powers that be, whether it's the religious leaders or the Roman leaders. But he was trying to force God's hand. And that's really where he messed up. And I think a lot of us can really learn from the dangers of trying to force God's hand, the right. dangers of getting impatient with God's will, and really learning from the life of Judas. You know, he was a traitor. I mean, but it wasn't all that he was. And I think when you label him just as a traitor, then you say, well, nothing he did is of value. And I'm like, hold up. There's lessons in the good and there's lessons in the bad. And I find a lot of lessons in the life of Judas that I'm like, oh, wow, like that's a cautionary tale for me. Like, hey, don't get impatient with God's plan. It's a cautionary tale for me. Like, don't try and force God's will. You know, God's in control. Let it happen.
Right. And honestly, I mean, the bottom line, Judas just missed the point, right? I mean, he totally missed the point. I think if you bring this forward and you know, with all of these different personalities, we can relate in all these different ways, right? And I see a lot of, well, look, Judas was very political. He was part of a political
system
at that time. The whole idea was to overthrow, get freedom from this Roman oppression. And he saw Jesus, and the way in which they read scripture, okay, was that, man, he's going to come be the savior, right? And they're going to pull them out of this room, get back to the way things ought to be. And I see sometimes we mix our Christian faith and politics, and we want to see Jesus for who we want Jesus to be. And Jesus, even in that moment, Jesus is offering grace all the way to the end, right? But Judas never took that. He never accepted that, because it was about what he wanted, not necessarily what was best for him that God was saying to him. And so, yes, Judas was a traitor, just as Thomas doubted and Peter messed up a lot of things.
Royally.
But Judas completely missed the point. And I think it's important for us to get back to this really understanding the biblical view of who Christ is, and accept who he is as he is revealing himself, not as we want him to reveal himself. And I think that's the issue of Judas. And Judas, of course, realizes at this point, where at a certain point, that he totally missed it. But I think he felt like it was too late for him. I don't know. There's a lot of missing components there, but obviously he took his life. And that's just a sad end note to Judas's life when things could have been different. And how many times in life are there people that had they just paused and listened to what the Lord wanted them to do? And so there are a number of these different personalities involved and engaged in this storyline. To take a look at the timeline, though, just hours before, so this day that we're looking at, the night before would have been the Last Supper, right?
Yeah.
It was a moment we see them sharing that meal together. It would have been Passover. And I think Jesus did two very significant things during the Passover, that meal. He did a number of things. I mean, washed your feet, a lot that went on that night. But two very significant things. One, he took Passover, which had significant meaning, right? It was the celebration of their exodus out of Egypt and their freedom. And Jesus put that on its head. And much like when he sat down and read Isaiah and then sat down saying, it's all about me. He said, this is all about me now, right? This is about my death, my burial, my resurrection. This is about true freedom and the escape from Egypt, sin, and all that restoration that this looks to. And so that's very significant what took place, just complete new direction. The second thing is that he identifies that night who's going to betray him. Of course, Judas, right? And what I find fascinating, I read this through a couple of times just recently, again, just in kind of preparation for this, and I'm just baffled that nobody seemed to catch that, even though Jesus said it very clearly.
It just went over their heads.
Yeah. But again, because they're not really listening. They're listening with their ears, not the ears that God. But he says, I'm going to dip this bread, and I want to hand it to you. And they didn't catch this. The other thing that's very significant about that is that Jesus was always in control. From the moment he was born, but from that moment he entered Jerusalem, that last week of Passion, all the way through, he had total control of all of those events. From that point until he actually dies, Jesus is in total control. Nobody else is the master here. And so he makes a point to say to Judas, now go do this thing.
Do what you have to do.
Yeah. And so he dismisses Judas. They go to the garden. Judas goes and does his thing. They go to the garden and the prayer happens. And Jesus this is his last moment on earth to be in prayer with his Heavenly Father. Jesus had a pattern, right? He would escape, go away to a quiet place to be alone with his Father. This was his last opportunity to do that. And that's all, of course, interrupted as Judas leads those that are coming to arrest him in the garden. And so they're there, they're arresting him. Judas kisses him. And this is also when Peter does his thing.
Cuts off the guy's ear.
Yeah. which is another amazing point in this account where I mean, Peter cuts this guy's ear off. There's this big scuffle, right? And this guy's here, and in the middle of this, Jesus lifts his ear up and puts it back on his head, and it doesn't seem to faze anybody in all of this.
I just think it's funny that nobody like stopped and was like, well, he is the Son of God. Maybe we should let him go.
Yeah.
And
we're not going to second guess this thing. and so that all happens. But then everybody scatters. Everybody scatters. They take Jesus and they lead him to the Sanhedrin. There, the Sadducees, the Pharisees all are gathered. Caiaphas is there. They have this mock trial where they accuse him of all kinds of things. Jesus stays silent. You know, Caiaphas too, right? So you've got all these different layers of people and what they want. Caiaphas is just holding on to power. I can't help but believe Caiaphas knew who Jesus was, and yet he's not willing to give it up.
Well, I mean, he was the religious, the head religious leader at the time. So whenever a rabbi would come, Caiaphas would be like, well, if he's a influential one, let me put him under my wing, you know, so that way he can be a part of my crew. And I mean, he held all the power, you know, at least from a religious perspective, and especially leading the Jewish people, you know, he was at the top. And so now you have somebody that's saying, it's like, no, it's like, it's not about being at the top. It's about serving. You know, and Jesus completely changed the perspective and changed the dynamic where Caiaphas was like, no, like, I want that. And so he was trying to hold on to that power in a very forceful way.
Yeah.
Yeah. And at the same time, he didn't have the authority to kill Jesus, which is why he had to get the Romans involved in order so that they could kill Jesus.
Right. Yeah. So just a further study into motivations, right? Caiaphas about power. And even others within the ranks of the Pharisees, we see that there's some give and take there, but you know, I don't know. I can only say so much because, you know, peer pressure, all the things that go into life happened right there, but the power, what I want versus what is best, it's what I want though. And then of course, just the genuineness of some, the two people we mentioned, Thomas and Peter, who certainly have flaws, but man, they can see who Christ is and they really want that. They don't know exactly how to get there, but that's that whole, balancing act of our life versus what Christ really wants to do in our life. And so they have the mock trial. They accuse him. They start beating on him. Caiaphas sends him away for the night. And the Bible talks about he's beaten further. I don't know what takes place overnight because they're going to deliver him to Pilate the next morning. And so it's a long night for him either way, whether he's finally left alone or, you know, to himself, or they continue to go in and torment him further. I don't know how that plays out. Nobody does. It's just a very long night. It's also during that moment, though, that Peter does another thing.
Peter denies Jesus publicly and runs away.
Yeah, yeah. Which then what that does is it brings us to this place to where, at this stage, Jesus is completely on his own, which is also very significant because when we talk about salvation, when we talk about what Jesus and where our lives are enhanced, it's Jesus alone. It's all about just Jesus, and our worship and our adoration and our commitment is to Jesus alone because it's only Jesus. Nobody else was there. It's all about him. He is the sacrifice, and nobody else can take any kind of credit. So he's left complete, even at a point on the cross where the Father seemingly, you know, abandons him. He cries out, and so it's all in Jesus. It's just all about Jesus.
One born for us.
Let's talk about the crucifixion now. Jesus Christ, God in flesh. So he's fully man, fully God. But he came to earth. He lived among us. And then on this day, Jesus' whole purpose culminates into this day where he dies for us. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24 says, he himself, goes back to, you know, it's Jesus alone. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. And by his wounds, the Bible says, you have been healed. So Jesus took all of humanity's sin and applied that to himself, an innocent one, someone who is blameless in every way possible. And Jesus makes this sacrifice. And he does so simply because he loves us that much. I mean, that is just an incredible thought of how powerful that. I mean, when you think about all of the sins of humanity, I mean, how do you measure that? How do you measure that?
Well, I think one of the things that sometimes people hear that and they think, oh, well, that God is, you know, to blame for all the sin, or that he in that point knew all the sin. But I think that actually robs of the reality of what was happening is like he was taking the punishment.
Yeah.
The judgment, you know, of all of our sins, you know, your punishment, my punishment, and we're literally going to put it on Jesus because that he was the scapegoat,
yes,
the biblical scapegoat, where in the Old Testament they would do it with an actual goat and they would, you know, put their sins onto the goat and then, you know, let it go. But Jesus is like, no, like I'm ending this once and for all.
Yeah. The weight of that,
yeah,
is incredible. So you think about, you know, the Bible talks about that sin for a season, but then, so, and we've all been caught, right? You take it back if you want to, you know, you're just this little kid and you threw the rock through the neighbor's window, crash, and it was fun until you heard the crash and then you heard mom. Or dad, even worse, right? And suddenly you go from this excitement to the downcast and that weight. When you think about that multiplied out, and all of that was on, he bore in himself all the sin of all mankind.
Whew. And the other part is he did it willingly. You know, it's one of those, it's like, when you read the story of Passion Week, you read he had multiple outs. Mm-hmm. He had multiple opportunities where he could have just, you know, ducked out and
right.
And but he always came back to this phrase of, you know, God, your will, not mine.
Not mine.
And that kept him going even through the difficulty. And I think that's the kind of tenacity that Jesus is displaying. Like, look, this is the greatest reflection of love.
Yes, yes. And just as a bit of a side note, I guess, is that what Jesus models for us, it's not my will, but your will, right? And so we look at, you know, Caiaphas. Even Judas, but even some of the others who, we wanted to go this way. Even us now, yeah. It's like there are moments like, Jesus, you need to do this for me, and I need to do it now.
Yeah.
But it's not about my will. And we're living in a world where we want to twist everything around and say, I know God says this, but you know he doesn't really mean that. Well, I think we need to come back and come back to that model of, Lord, your will, not my will.
I heard a pastor say this. He said, if Jesus hates all the people that you hate, you made God in your own image.
Wow.
And I really like that statement.
Wow.
Because, I mean, if you find yourself in that point where, oh, yeah, God hates everybody I hate, it's like, look, at that point, you made God in your own image.
Yeah. So hundreds of years earlier, before this event, Prophet Isaiah writes these words. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. See, Jesus was oppressed, right? Jesus experienced all of this. In his entire lifespan on the earth, he experienced, he was constantly being stalked and harassed, questioned, and then they finally capture him, and ultimately they torture him, they torment him, and of course they kill him. And he did that willingly because he loves us. It says he was afflicted. That implies this kind of humiliation, being brought low. It's this idea of being treated with great contempt. And so we see that being belittled. And that happened in the trial. It happened while he's on the cross. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he literally went from hero, you know, during Palm Sunday.
Yeah.
And everybody was cheering him on. They were, you know, putting their cloaks down in front of him, parading him around the city. Like, he went from the guy.
Yeah.
To the one that they would later parade, you know, as a cross on his back and beat and humiliate and disfigure. Mm-hmm. And he spoke up to God, you know, when he prayed.
Yeah.
But he didn't speak up for himself.
No.
In front of others.
No. Yeah. So, and we're talking about really hard stuff here. When you pause and I know, see, sometimes we get, I think, so accustomed to the story that we miss these incredible jewels that are in there. So this idea of, Jesus became the sacrificial lamb. And when you think about what took place on the sacrifice, right? Before this, people would bring, you know, animals to be sacrificed. And I think about, you know, that day, the Day of Atonement, all of this, that, man, what a brutal scene that had to be. It's literally blood, because they have troughs, you know, that would collect the blood. It's just a horrendous scene. And Jesus does that. He's being led to that point where he is going to be brutally killed. It's a tremendous image that is painted for us, and that Jesus literally lives through. So further, in verse 8, Isaiah 53, says, by oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgressions of my people. This is a prophet hundreds of years earlier laying this all out. And Jesus, almost like a script, you know, he's playing it out. And of course, you know, there's no way that he can, though he's in complete control, and in that way, you know, yes, they're making, this is all happening because God's will, but in terms of the earthly view, how can you not see that this is a tremendous moment, and there's no way that can be earthly orchestrated. It's incredible. I mean, right down to the fact that he was, you know, sheared, right? So he's stripped. I mean, look, nobody has ever been more naked than Jesus was on the cross that day in terms of everything about his being stripped and laid bare. And he did it so that he could have all of that weight laid on him. And so all things, his friends left him, his honor left him, his dignity left him, his divine protection left him, everything. He's left bare there on the hill of Golgotha. And that's what Good Friday is. Literally, that is what Good Friday is. And what I think is incredible is that his response, you alluded to it a moment ago. He stood there and he said not a word. I couldn't do that. Could you?
My favorite disciple's Peter.
Exactly. There you go. He was silent. He did not open his mouth. Except to say, Father.
Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Wow. It's incredible just to hear that and to know that Jesus did all of this to put right what has become so wrong. And it's all about forgiving us of everything we've ever done. He loved us that much. I love this verse too. Isaiah chapter 25, verse 8 and 9. It says, he will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. And the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken, it will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him, that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. So let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. That is what we take away from this. Certainly there's a lot of sad notes here, right? But the reality is that what God wants us to really see is that because of what he did for us, we get to rejoice, right? Hallelujah.
Well, I mean, that's why it's called Good Friday.
It's called
horrible events, like horrible, but favorable results.
So we can turn our sadness to joy and literally sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
should the fire that once burned bright become an
This is Good Friday, and when Jesus was taking time to prepare his disciples for his eventual death, he was sharing a number of things, but one of the things that he talked about was that he's going to die, right? He'd be buried in the ground, and we see all of those things take place. On this Good Friday, we leave Jesus in the grave. But Sunday's coming, right? Easter's on its way. Resurrection is coming. But he also gives, Jesus gives another assurance. Certainly, we're going to celebrate Easter. And that's what it is. It is a celebration. There's no time for mourning because Jesus is alive. But Jesus gives this other assurance. He tells his disciples and he tells all of us that if he dies and he goes away, he's going to come back. Jesus is coming back to take us home to be with him. And that is the hope that we all have. That is what makes this day, you know, so significant. Jesus had to die. But as I said, he's always been in control and he's still in control. He was in control when he went in the grave. And now he's still in control. He's seated at the right hand of the Father and he is returning one day to take us to be with him. So let me share this this passage with you. John chapter 16, verse 22 says, "So also you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you." We're living in tough times, stressful times, challenging things happen in our lives in general. And I just want to give you this. Jesus did all of these things, as we've had this conversation. Jesus did all of this because he loves us. He loves you. And his greatest desire is to form a relationship with you. And I just want to invite you today, as I've invited you to come along with this conversation, this is a moment where I now invite you to say yes to Jesus. Jesus loves you. And he died for you. He laid in the grave for you. He was resurrected for you. He ascended into heaven and he's seated at the right hand of the Father. And he says that he is making intercession right now. He's praying for you. And he's coming back for you. All we have to do is say yes. Say, "God, come in. Take this sin from me. I repent. I turn away from my former way and I want to follow you." That's just how simple it is. And so I want to pray with you. And you can just pray, "Lord Jesus, come into my heart, come into my life, set me free. Give me the strength to turn away from my past life and begin to follow you." Let's pray. Father, we pause now and we say thank you. Thank you for sending Jesus. John chapter 3, verse 16, "You did so because you love us so much." Thank you, Jesus, for coming and doing all that you have done. You came to seek and to save those who are lost. That's me. It's Pastor Marcos. That's so many others that have come to this realization that I need a Savior. And so at this moment, Lord, I pray for those that are making this decision. God, as they are saying to you right now, "Lord, come into my life," I say yes to you. That, Lord, you will give them that assurance right now. And then, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will lead them to just follow you, to find a place where they can dig in and learn more about you, a place where they'll be surrounded by other persons who have also found you and allowed you to be their Savior and their Lord, and that together we can walk together and form this wonderful relationship and to grow in you. We're all messed up, Lord. We're all either Peter or Thomas, hopefully not Judas. But we all have flaws. We all have challenges. But you love us and you offer us your grace. And for that, I am so thankful. I'm thankful for this day. Today is a good day because of what it means for me and so many others. And for those that are saying yes to you right now, going forward. We thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, thank you for joining us today. We're glad that you did so. Join with us on Easter Sunday morning, 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock. And you'll be glad that you did. God bless you.